All right, Senator, we have everyone aligned. You can say hello if you're ready to begin.
Hey, Senator Braun here. I think we'll go right into questions.
All right, we've got about 15, 20 minutes and quite a few outlets on the call. So if we can keep it to one question and maybe a follow-up if you need it. Start with top of the list, WIBC. Do we have Eric?
Hi, Senator. Thanks for doing this.
Hi, Eric.
So obviously confirmation hearings are going on for Judge Jackson. You're not on that committee. You've expressed some skepticism about this nomination in the past. Have you met with her personally, and have you formed an opinion as to which way you will vote?
Have not met her. I think she did that mostly with the folks on the Judiciary Committee. Of course, you can't miss the topic. Seems well qualified. But whenever I vote for a Supreme Court justice, it's going to be basically, how are you going to interpret the law? If your record shows that you're going to be kind of an activist there, I don't think that's good. I don't think the founders intended it that way. I'm going to look at what's fleshed out in terms of prior rulings at a lower level. And I think that'll be done thoroughly. And I think our side that is going to be doing some of that extraction of information based upon your record. We'll do it in a way that I think hopefully keeps it at a little different level of decorum than the one I remember back when I was running and I think October of 18 with Kavanaugh. So stick with interpreting the law. Don't legislate from the bench. And what has your prior record shown about what you'll do when you're on the main stage?
If I could follow up, you said that's what you're going to do. Is it fair to say that you've not formed an opinion yet, or what have
no,
you
found I'm going to wait
so
until
far?
I'm going to wait until the whole process finishes itself out. Of course, in this day of information, you get a lot ahead of time, and I think she'll have to do a pretty strong explanation of why her record and maybe what her judicial tendency might be to say the opposite of what I said will be the most important criteria for me.
Thanks, Eric. We have Wish TV. Okay, no Wish, will come back to you. Fox 59, we have Dan.
Yeah, hi, Senator Braun.
Hi, Dan.
Do you suspect that, hi there. Do you suspect this will be a purely partisan vote, or might we see some Republicans cross over and vote to confirm Judge Jackson?
Well, I don't think there'll be any Democrat voting against her. And I think it remains to be seen in terms of how much would be brought out along the lines of what I talked about. I think there are probably three or four Republicans that would maybe lean that direction. But if the case is made that with prior opinions at lower court levels, and her answers to what she wants to accomplish, they generally are understated if you're talking about judicial activism. Everyone basically, in a perfunctory way, will say, I'm going to be neutral, look at the merits of the case. I think that'll determine whether it's purely a partisan vote or not. We'll see what happens.
What do you think we'll see in terms of the decorum in this hearing? You mentioned it, the desire to not have it end up being like a Kavanaugh hearing, as you put it. But we did have some questions today. Senator Graham asked her to describe on a scale of 1 to 10 how religious of a person she was. Do you think that kind of question is appropriate in this format?
Well, that would be a question that I think is one that may not be of the analytical kind of context that would hit the mark, but I'm referring back to the absolute bedlam that occurred during the Kavanaugh hearings. And that was a level of decorum that I think most on our side said they would not go there. And I think we'll get to the merits of the case on her capabilities without some of those histrionics.
Thank you, Senator. Appreciate
it. Indianapolis Star.
Hi, Senator. It's Caitlin Lang.
Hi, Caitlin.
I wanted to ask about your statement on Twitter about the veto of the sports bill. Holcomb has said he vetoed the measure in part because it's a solution looking for, you know, that for a problem that doesn't exist in Indiana and appears to already be being addressed. Any response to that part of his veto letter?
I didn't think that was a very good direct response. Cite 11 other states that have probably done something otherwise, another 20 looking at it. Also cite that this has got a wide majority of Americans, 62%, that don't think that you should have biological males competing in female sports. Much higher than that among independents and Republicans, and even 41% of Democrats. So I think that that also would have, in Indiana, even more than a 62% support level. So I think the governor did go against maybe what the majority of people are thinking across the country, especially in Indiana. And I thought the response maybe was a way to kind of sidewind around the essence of the discussion.
Now, you don't normally criticize, you know, members of your own party, especially in Indiana. Why was this important enough issue to say something on Twitter, you know, almost immediately after?
Yeah, this is one issue that I'm going to always be on the side of never demonizing anybody that disagrees with me, number one. But there will be some issues that I think are going to need to have a counterpoint made to it. Again, acknowledging that you're never going to agree with anybody on everything. This climbed the threshold to where I thought it was worth making a statement about, and I think most Hoosiers are lined up with me on that statement.
Thanks, Caitlin. We have Tom Davies, the AP.
Hello, Senator. It's along that same line. Why decide to weigh in on this when it's not a federal issue, but instead looking at strictly a state issue, or do you see it differently?
Well, any of these issues can become federal issues in time through the courts or federal legislation. And I think in this case, at least it's at a level where it looks like states are making these kinds of decisions. And I believe this is the bailiwick of the states, just like I think, you know, on other issues where the feds, either through courts or legislation, in moments of opportunity, go otherwise. And I think here, this is not an issue that snuck up on us. I cited the number of other states that have already passed guidelines, the 20 other states that are in the process of doing it, and to where current polling exists in terms of what state governments should do. This one, I think, has more clarity to it. I think it still needs to be done in the context of having rational debate on both sides. This one, I think the evidence is clearly in favor of what the legislature did do. Was disappointed that the governor vetoed it.
Do you think the Congress should step in and do something on this issue?
No, I think this is a classic case where the federal government ought to stay out of it. This should be something that is reflected throughout the diversity of states. Perfect example where I think that's where it should stay, and that's where it's at currently.
Thanks, Tom. Going to Fort Wayne now. Nikki Kelly with the Journal Gazette, and then we'll go to WPTA after that. Nikki? No Nikki yet. WPTA, we got you.
Good afternoon, Senator. Jonathan Shelley. I'm the news director at WPTA. You were just touching on kind of a classic federal versus state regulation debate. You signed on to a letter with 25 senators regarding concerns over the federal government's regulation of firearms and how that could infringe upon Second Amendment rights. At the same time, we're seeing states, Indiana now included as of yesterday, passing legislation that would seem to loosen regulation. How do you assess the current state of the Second Amendment, and what roles do you see the state and federal government playing as that all gets sorted out in terms of how far government should go in requiring permits and regulating weapons?
So Second Amendment rights are clearly embedded in the Constitution, and I think that there's been a constant attempt among some states to erode that Second Amendment right. So everything's got a different dynamic. The issue on the bill back in Indiana has not gotten to the federal level. For ones that are embedded in our Constitution, that's a whole nother issue. And again, I think that in places like maybe California, New York, our neighbors to the west, Illinois, where they've tried to erode that constitutional right, you got to be careful. There are all different ways the government can weigh in from one end to the other, trying to erode something embedded in the Constitution or an issue that is evolving, like the one here in Indiana where the governor vetoed this bill. So I say stay alert. I'm a big believer that if you're going to get through the contention that always comes from these discussions, that there has to be more latitude among the states and less one size fits all on anything that does not seem to have worked over the years where it comes to statute, court rulings in some case. Got Roe versus Wade, where the Supreme Court's going to weigh in on something that occurred nearly 50 years ago. I think that's part of the way we navigate through issues that are generally going to be divisive, that are generally very vitriolic, and you solve that by not trying to nationalize it, which one side of the aisle out here wants to do more of that all the time, and I think we've gone far enough there into a variety of issues.
What about with how that would apply, that same question would apply to marijuana legalization? Is that something handled better on the state level?
I think that's given us a clear pathway from the number of states that have either legalized recreational or medical use of marijuana. I know that that's been a discussion in state, and I'm glad to see that that is evolving, even in a way where there's some nullification to federal law out there, because that's an issue that I think should be discussed at the state level. I'm guessing it'll be a more important topic of conversation in Indiana, simply extrapolating the trend of what's occurred in many states across the country, especially those surrounding us.
Thank you. We'll go to Adam Wren next, and then WSBT with Robert Borelli after that. Adam? Okay, no, Adam. Do we have WSBT?
Yes, thank you. Just wondering what the current view is on the situation in Ukraine.
So that, for me, is an easy one. When our intel showed us back in September and October, if not before, that this was all going to eventuate, like we've seen, the old ounce of prevention being worth a pound of cure comes into play. I think also when you project weakness, like the Biden administration has done from the get-go, the pickle, the predicament we're in, is not hard to understand. The big question is, what do we do that we're now marred within it? I think there you got to be careful. I've been very clear that it would be a mistake to engage troops in another situation similar to what we just got out of in Afghanistan. We were in it many years ago in Iraq, even go back to the Vietnam War. But I see some good things happening. I see the EU finally waking up to defending their own backyard. President Trump talked about that in terms of paying your fair share. And I think it is clear. Putin is an international thug that looks like he wants to go into the pantheon of dictators of the worst repute. And he has probably bitten off more than what he can chew. We need to be enabling the Ukrainians as much as we can by sanctioning their economy. For Hoosier viewers that don't know it, they are a small economy, about the size of Florida's, less than 50% the size of Germany's, 1/13 the size of ours, and about the same percentage of the EU. We can do what needs to be done to further make Russia a pariah and show Putin that you can't be an international thug, invade another country, and get by with it.
NWI, we have Dan Cardin.
Hey, Senator. You spoke about judicial activism. If the Supreme Court later this year strikes down the right to abortion, would you consider that to be judicial activism, legislating from the bench?
I consider it to have been judicial activism when it occurred back almost 50 years ago. So I think this would be bringing it back to a neutral point to where that issue should have never been federalized. Way out of sync, I think, with the contour of America then. And this basically puts it back to a point where, like most of these issues, where one side of the aisle wants to homogenize it federally, is not the right way to do it. This should be something where the expression of individual states are able to weigh in on these issues through their own legislation, through their own court systems. Quit trying to put the federal government in charge of not only things like we did navigating through COVID recently, where I think that was misguided, but in general. So no, I think this takes it back to a point where it should have never gotten beyond in the first place.
That same basis to something like Loving versus Virginia, the Supreme Court case that legalized interracial marriage.
So when it comes to issues, you can't have it both ways. When you want that diversity to shine within our federal system, there are going to be rules and proceedings. They're going to be out of sync with maybe what other states would do. It's the beauty of the system, and that's where the differences among points of view in our 50 states ought to express themselves. And I'm not saying that rule would apply in general, depending on the topic, but it should mostly be in general, because it's hard to have it on issues that you just are interested in when you deny it for others with a different point of view.
So you would be okay with the Supreme Court leaving the question of interracial marriage to the states?
Yes, I think that that's something that if you're not wanting the Supreme Court to weigh in on issues like that, you're not going to be able to have your cake and eat it too. I think that's hypocritical.
What about Griswold versus Connecticut?
You can list a whole host of issues. When it comes down to whatever they are, I'm going to say that they're not going to all make you happy within a given state, but that we're better off having states manifest their points of view rather than homogenizing it across the country as Roe versus Wade did. Thanks.
Brock Turner, IPB, or IPM rather.
Hi, Senator. Do you think this House Speaker and House leadership should call lawmakers back to override House Bill 1041?
When that happens, I think, which occurs normally, I think it ought to be on the agenda for an override. I think when I cited how overwhelming that issue is across the country, even disproportionately more so in Indiana, among independents and Republicans, and close to 50-50 among Democrats, yes. I think if you don't, you're kind of sticking your head in the sand and avoiding a conflict that in this case needs to be fleshed out to where you put that up to an override vote.
And then in terms of permitless carry, I know Governor Holcomb did sign that bill. Any reaction to the permitless carry legislation that was going through the State House? And do you see that as a state or federal issue? Like, is that something that the federal government should also be involved in?
the right is embedded in the Constitution, and I think it's perfect grounds for reinforcing that constitutional right where it might have eroded or to where you've not been active in the space. So that's a different dynamic from federalizing a lot of other stuff that has no mention in the Constitution. So those are two different kinds of issues.
Okay, we've hit 12:35. Thanks, everybody. Every outlet will receive the full video of the call. Thank you to the Senate Republican Studio for hosting.